What up, everybody? It's your boy Jordan.
And this is Desmond.
And welcome to episode 6 of Two Black Nerds. We back at it again this week, y'all. We got some really interesting stuff to get to this week. We got some movie-related news, but we also got some interesting stuff that we just found out about today from the Camp Flog Gnaw Music Festival out in L.A. We're going to be talking about some streaming platforms, you know, really hitting us real soon. And then there's been like a lot of new trailers that have dropped that we want to sort of get to. But, you know, before we dive into this week's topic, man, like, have you heard any feedback about the show so far? We're 6 episodes in right now. It's been about a month since we launched. Ooh, which is kind of crazy. It's gone by fast. But any feedback from last week's episodes, or any episode for that matter?
Not too much, man. You know, the same old vibes, chilling, thrilling, villain. No, I was just playing. Everything has been pretty good though, man. I think I did get a little bit of feedback where people don't understand that we do talk about more than movies.
Oh yeah.
You know,
yeah.
On this podcast. And so I just want everyone to know that nerddom is not, you know, defined, you know, by just movies. That just happens to be, you know, one of the areas that we've seen the black lens lacking, right?
Yeah.
And so that's just the basis of what we do, and we build on top of that. So
very much, man. There's a lot that we're always going to talk about. Like, yeah, we're definitely not limited to just movie news. Like, you're going to hear us talk about all sorts of things. And I know last week we even put out like a word for like people to send us like topics and things that they want to hear about. Like, and I think we definitely got some good ideas.
We did get some good ideas.
Which I'm really interested to, you know, hopefully dive into some point. Maybe we'll do like an all like fan topic episode at some point.
Yeah,
in the future.
That could be really good.
That could be really intriguing to see like what you all want us to sort of chat about and hear our opinions about. So hopefully we can get that to you all real soon. In the meantime though, just want to make sure to let you all know to subscribe to us on whichever platform you get your podcast
all of them.
Spotify, yeah. Apple, yeah. Google, YouTube, Breaker, Radio, yep. Public, all of them, the whole litany of podcasts that are available.
Catch us at your bootlegger's corner. No, just playing.
Find us wherever videos are sold. All of that good stuff. Definitely subscribe. And if you can, you know, leave us a review. I know Apple takes reviews and
please
and
leave
ratings.
A nice Apple podcast review.
Yeah, man.
We'd appreciate it.
We definitely want that good feedback. And, you know, it's always appreciated to hear some positive words of affirmation. Or even, you know, go to our YouTube channel. Or watch a clip, leave a comment.
Which people have.
Yeah, I've seen a few comments on
some
things.
I was like, my bad.
Yeah. Right. We had to get some fact checking going on. Like, oh, we got that wrong. But you know, it's cool. You know, we're not perfect. We're always open to that criticism, constructive criticism. So definitely hit us up wherever you get your podcast. And make sure to also follow us on social media, please. Instagram and Twitter. At Two Black Nerds. So we really got to talk about this Camp Flog Gnaw Music Festival situation.
Please.
That just happened. Like, it's actually kind of crazy. So I woke up to this news this morning. I didn't know what was going on, but the headline was like, Drake gets booed off stage. And I'm like, wait, what? Like, Drake,
Drake?
Getting booed? That doesn't make any sense.
No.
Come to find out, he makes a surprise appearance at Tyler, the Creator's Music Festival, Camp Flog Gnaw in L.A. Nobody knew he was going to be there. He wasn't advertised. And apparently the story goes that people were expecting Frank Ocean to make an appearance.
Mm-hmm.
And people have been going to Camp Flog Gnaw for like 5 years, anticipating, oh, Frank Ocean's going to come this year, or he's going to come next year, or the year after that, whatever. And, you know, Frank doesn't make any appearances. That man just, like, he be chilling somewhere else, like,
right,
doing his own thing. But then Drake comes out, big surprise, obviously, like, I think a good majority of the audience goes crazy, but then people started booing him, like, for whatever reason. Apparently they were, like, upset because Frank didn't come, or what, like, I don't know why people started booing, per se,
yeah,
but they started booing Drake, and then eventually that made him, like, leave the stage. But he left in a real professional way. Like, he didn't get, like, salty or anything to the audience. Like, he just kept it real professional and just, like, kind of walked off stage and ended his set early. And you could tell he was going to perform more, but he definitely ended it early. It's just crazy that, like, people did this to, like, one of the biggest artists in the world. I don't get it.
Yeah, I believe people said he had 5 songs in his set, I believe.
Mm, yeah, yeah.
And when he was like, hey, I'm here for you tonight. If you want to keep going, I will keep going. What's up? And they just kept booing. And somebody in the crowd was like, no.
Like,
and
no.
He was just like, all right, it's been love, and walked out. And for me, that is like one of the most professional things I've ever seen.
Yeah.
Right? Have you seen that Ja Rule clip where he's just like, are you ready?
Yep. He was at the All-Star game or something like that. Nobody responded.
It's still one of the funniest things.
It's the funniest thing.
Are you ready?
And I got to get up to Ja. He even kind of handled that In the most professional way in that moment.
Yeah, he still did pretty good.
Yeah, it's just, it's weird, man. Like, I don't know. I guess I just got to be honest. Like, I really feel like that's, like, some entitled bullshit from, like, fans. Like,
no, yeah.
He wasn't even advertised for the festival. So, like, him coming out or even, like, ASAP Rocky, these other surprise, you know, appearances.
Yeah.
They're not, like, a part of the set list. They're not guaranteed to be there. This is all just extra stuff at this point.
Yeah.
And so the fact that people felt the need to, like, boo, you know, just because like they thought something else was gonna happen, it's just really weird to me, man, especially for someone with the caliber of Drake. Like that's one of the biggest artists in the world
ever, really,
like King's, we're gonna be honest, like dead ass, like, so it's just crazy, like how are you in the audience, bro? Like how are you that upset, like, that this man is performing hits, songs that he never performs, by the way,
people who would love to be there. I know when I heard he was performing Feel No Ways.
Oh my God.
When I heard he was performing Wu-Tang Forever, I'm like, so why am I not at
Yeah,
Camp
like,
Flog
why didn't I go? Yeah.
It doesn't make any sense, man.
Oh, man, that's crazy.
And for Drake to be one of Tyler's favorite artists ever, right?
True.
And Tyler, I think he made a request, like, I want to hear Feel No Ways.
Oh, yeah,
and
yeah.
Drake really performed it.
Yeah.
And so you see this, like, this clip of Tyler just dancing to Feel No Ways.
Hella happy.
Like, hella happy, yeah. Almost by himself. He's isolated, you know what I'm saying? And that is just...
That's the crazy thing. That's like, that's Tyler's festival.
People really had the nerve to boo this man that Tyler wanted, and it's his festival.
Yeah.
It blows my mind.
That also, that's weird, because I saw some people trying to make the excuse like, oh, you know, this isn't the audience for like Drake. This is kind of like outside of like his audience. And I think, first of all, that's bullshit.
That is bullshit.
Drake touches every audience. That's why he's as big as
he is. That's why he's Drake.
Right, that's why he's Drake. And then on top of like what you just mentioned, Tyler handpicked him and any other guest artist that he had because he curates this festival every year. So like the people that he's into, he felt like, oh, you know, my audience would respect this person. Like I'm bringing these two worlds together.
Right.
And then he also requested specific songs that Drake doesn't typically perform. So like this is a really unique experience that they would be getting that normally, like if you just go to a regular Drake tour, you're not hearing Feel No Ways. Like, you would never hear that, you
except
know?
For the only time I know he performed it is when Views came out.
Right, like, right after it came out, right? Like, because it was high in top of mind. But, like, also, like, Wu-Tang Forever, like, you're not hearing that stuff.
You're
so
not
it's just
hearing
like,
it.
It's crazy, man. Like, I woke up to it, and I was just like, wow, people are really, like, crazy. I'm just like, yeah, we can't be disrespected. Like, no matter how you feel about Drake, like, you can't deny what type of artist he is and how talented he is and, like, the fact that he did not have to be there. You know what I'm saying? Like, that's just crazy that people just weren't more appreciative of that moment. Like, if I was there, I would have lost my shit because I'm like, I didn't pay for Drake, but we now all of a sudden got Drake.
Are we getting old?
Man, maybe. I don't know. Maybe
like,
maybe
I'm
it's a younger
think,
crowd, right?
Like, maybe some people that were at Camp Flog Gnaw were like, I don't know. Let's say they just turned 18, right?
Sure.
And for me, I started listening to Drake in 08.
Okay.
So
a little bit over a decade.
Say, again, 18, 11 years. Say they were like six, seven years old when Drake came out.
True.
Maybe they don't feel the same way that I feel. Like maybe their fandom, but it still doesn't make sense to me.
Yeah, but I mean, you can make the same argument for Frank, couldn't you? You know, like
if
that's who they wanted to see. Well, like
Channel Orange came out 2010.
2012. Yeah, so a little bit later. So I mean, Drake has been like more prominent for a little bit of a longer time. But I don't know. I don't know why people decided to take that approach. Like,
yeah, it's still wild.
Yeah,
it's
so
still wild. I know DJ Academics actually talked to Drake real quick, and he said he told him personally, talking about the performance, that it's a moment of humility, which is always welcome. And Drake also said it was not my night, and it wasn't who they wanted to see.
Wow.
Just really simple.
That's classy,
straight to
man.
The point.
Yeah.
It really is. Like, no matter what you say about Drake, if you like him and don't like him, he handled it very well.
That's super classy. Cause
yeah,
listen,
it's poised.
I think we've seen like other art forms and like other entertainers who've been booed off stage before,
right,
and they don't handle it anywhere near as well as he did.
Oh no, they'd be cussing at people right back. I remember like
a comedian, if
Tiffany Haddish did it, I think.
Yeah.
Well, she like forgot her whole set.
She got a little upset. I think, you know, I don't want to speak ill of like the dead, but I think Charlie Murphy at one point, like he had got booed and like he got really upset with the crowd during like a stand up special.
Yeah,
so I mean,
it happens.
Yeah, it's like an entertainer is an artist, like I get it, because it's like you're really sensitive about your shit at the end of the day. And so if like people are not receptive to it, like, cool, yeah, you gonna fire back. I get that. But Drake, I mean, under all of that pressure in that moment, he just kept it real simple and classy and just kept it pushing, you know, and didn't really make a fuss of it. So I gotta just pay respect to him for that. And shame on y'all at Camp Flog Gnaw for not being more preachy.
Damn. Just trash.
We can't have nothing.
Man, one of the best, he's not even like a C-list or B-list. Like, he is literally one of the best artists to ever live.
Oh, seriously.
And there's
yeah.
many things down the rubric to prove it, you know, yeah, right? And yeah. it's like, again, if you're at a festival and there's all these people performing and you got him for free.
Yeah.
You don't even, you technically in my mind, I don't have to enjoy it. If I was there and there was somebody I like or I don't like came on, all right, y'all. So, confession, I don't like Kevin Gates. But if like, I don't like Kevin Gates. But Kevin Gates is on stage and he just happened to be there, I'm not going to boo him.
No.
I'm going to sit there and listen.
Yeah.
I do like music in general, right? So, like, I'm just going to vibe. But, you know, I'm not going to sit here and boo Kevin Gates.
Nah. Like, or if you don't want to listen, like, it is a festival. You can go do other things.
Either there was another stage, and maybe there was another stage. Yeah. Go eat.
There's food vendors.
Or just do something else.
Just take some pictures, like something.
But booing, though? Yeah, Come on, dog.
It's a waste of energy. It's just not. Yeah. That's just not suitable, man.
I don't care how much you love Frank. I love Frank more than the next person, and that ain't it.
That's not it at all. So, yeah, that was just really weird. Do better, you know, fans. Like, when y'all go to these festivals, just do better, man. Be more appreciative and just, like, recognize, like, these people don't have to take out the time to do this type of stuff. It's all extra to make y'all happy. So, that's what we're going to say about that. Camp Flog Gnaw and the Drake situation. I guess we'll move on, man, and get to some movie news. We'll talk about a really anticipated superhero movie coming out in 2021.
Yeah.
The next Batman movie, which is rumored to be entitled The Batman. Mm-hmm. It's going to be directed by Matt Reeves, who directed Dawn for the Planet of the Apes and War for the Planet of the Apes. Mm-hmm. It's been very anticipated for years now. Like, we heard about him signing on, like, over 2 years ago.
You just named The Planet of the Apes. That's easily... It could be top five trilogies of the decade.
Yeah,
easy.
Low key. That's easy. All I really need to know, like, to be like, oh, I'm confident this is gonna
easy.
Be
easy. It's sensational.
Yeah. So in these past couple of weeks, we've gotten like some big casting news. Like, we're starting to really see the cast like formulate around like what this movie is gonna be, and so like it's looking like really solid. And so at this point, like, we got Robert Pattinson obviously in the title role as Batman, Bruce Wayne.
Yeah.
He was casted a while ago, and we learned about him being a part of the movie. We've already touched on Zoe Kravitz being Selena Kyle, aka Catwoman.
Yeah.
Really excited about that.
I am.
Just to add on to the list, like, some people that we haven't really had the chance to talk about, Jeffrey Wright is going to be playing Police Commissioner Gordon.
That's going to be...
Oh, man.
I just hope they give him screen time.
Please.
Because Jeffrey Wright is already amazing.
Yeah.
And we already know, like, Commissioner Gordon kind of goes up and down in terms of screen time,
yeah,
right?
True.
But... ew, just give it to him.
Because J.K. Simmons in Justice League didn't have that much screen time as Commissioner Gordon.
Right.
You know, he wasn't in it that much. And I love J.K., and I would have liked to see more, but I agree. Like, let's do a lot with this Commissioner Gordon. And I think that they will, and we'll talk about that in a second with, like, who else they've casted. But they've also casted Paul Dano as Edward Nigma, a.k.a. the Riddler.
Yeah, we talked about him a little bit, too.
Yeah, a little bit. We touched on that. That's obviously one of Batman's most iconic villains. We haven't seen the Riddler on screen in quite a while, since Jim Carrey,
right?
Yeah, it's been a while. So that'll be interesting to see him back. The newer additions that have happened over the past week, this is where it gets really, like, interesting. So we have Colin Farrell.
Crazy.
Who was playing Oswald Cobblepot, a.k.a. the Penguin.
I don't even...
Wow. Now, this was the role that the rumor was that Jonah Hill was going after before negotiations broke down with his involvement. And apparently it was like salary negotiations didn't work out. But this was the rumor role he was going to play. Now we have Colin Farrell playing the Penguin. What are your thoughts about that, man? Like, we haven't seen the Penguin on screen since the early 90s film Batman Returns,
Danny.
With Danny DeVito.
Yeah.
So this will be the first time we're seeing it back. What are your thoughts on Colin Farrell?
I'm still trying to figure it out, right? Because a lot of people thought... Some people were upset that Jonah Hill was going after the Penguin role because they didn't want him to be typecasted. But in my mind, it doesn't make any sense, because if you're made for a role, you're made for a role. That's like saying Ryan Reynolds got typecasted into Deadpool.
Right?
You're
yeah,
like, no, he was born for this role.
That's who he should
be
playing.
And Jonah Hill kind of looks like a penguin to a lot of people. That's okay.
True.
Not, I mean, the character, right? Not like an actual penguin.
Yeah.
But he looks like he could definitely kill the Penguin role. So bringing in Colin Farrell, I don't know yet, right?
Yeah.
Like, it's kind of, in my mind, they didn't typecast, right? Like, Colin Farrell doesn't look like a person I'll pay the Penguin. But for me, it makes me more excited, right?
Yeah.
What can this person bring to this character that I might not be seeing in the foreseeable future?
For sure.
And I think he'll do amazing. It's Colin Farrell.
Yeah. Colin Farrell has a really great resume. I think he's a fine actor. Mm-hmm. I'm really excited to see what he'll bring to the role. And again, we haven't seen the Penguin on screen in quite a while. That'll be a different dimension of a villain that we have not explored. And I actually think, like, the Penguin is one of, you know, not my favorite Batman villains, but I really do enjoy like just the storyline and his relationship to Bruce
I like how weird the Penguin is.
Yeah,
right?
Super strange.
He's super strange. He's not like Joker weird. He's just different. He's just weird. He's just a weird guy. Yeah. And I think Colin Farrell do a good job. What was the last Colin Farrell movie you seen?
Probably Widows. Probably Widows.
Oh, shoot, yeah, I forgot about
that. He was in Widows.
The thing that comes to my mind is actually Fantastic Beasts. That was like 3 years ago or something.
Oh,
like that.
He
was in, that's like the thing that comes to my mind. The last thing he was in.
Yeah, he plays a lot of like service roles almost. Like he's typically like in supporting roles, but I think he always knocks it out of the park. So
he does.
Excited about that. The next one we have, I'm also really excited about this and did not see it coming. But it actually makes all the sense in the world
really?
When you really think about it, I think. Andy Serkis is playing Alfred Pennyworth.
It still blows my mind, honestly.
Which I feel like with Alfred as a character, we're going in so many different directions, like in the past like decade for like who this character is, like versus the way he was depicted in the Dark Knight trilogy with like Michael Caine, versus like how he was portrayed in the Gotham TV show.
Yeah.
To now there's like a Pennyworth TV series that airs on Epics.
Epics.
Mm-hmm. So it's like Alfred as a character has actually like grown a lot of stock over the past decade. But Andy Serkis, I mean,
I don't even
that's different.
Yeah, it's another character I honestly don't see yet.
Yeah.
Because Andy is so, I don't even know what the word is. His versatility doesn't, even though he's crazy versatile, still doesn't fit Alfred Pennyworth, right? Like he's Caesar and he's, you know what I mean? He's Schmeagle. Yeah, he's Gollum.
Yeah.
And you're just like, oh, so all of a sudden you're going to be Alfred Pennyworth?
Yeah.
Or like, you can even think, even most recently, he was in Black Panther, right?
True.
And you're just like,
as Claw,
you're just like, you're gonna be Alfred?
Yeah, yeah. It's different for sure. I think the reason it makes sense for me only because like Matt Reeves and him have worked together
because
of the Caesar role, right? So I think Matt Reeves probably, I mean, he knows the talent level of Andy Serkis. We know Andy Serkis is incredibly talented. You know,
I mean, for me,
does all the things.
For me, this is arguably the heaviest hitter on the whole cast. Andy Serkis is
quite possibly
is a legend at this point.
Yeah,
like, not just in as an actor, but as a like face. You know what I mean? Like he does good all around. Like this is Andy Serkis.
People know who he is.
Yeah. And now he has these characters that are just known globally at this point.
No, totally. I'm really excited about him being a part of the cast. And then just added like before the recording of the show, we have a newcomer, Jamie Lawson, who is been, you know, casted in an unconfirmed role. We don't know who she's playing, but she's fresh out of like Juilliard. Like she just finished school and she's now joining this huge blockbuster movie. Now people are speculating who she's gonna play. I'm hearing a lot of Barbara Gordon.
I mean,
hearing a lot of that.
I mean, you got a black Commissioner Gordon.
Yep.
And then you add another black girl.
Listen.
So it's like people are trying to put two and two together, right?
Yeah.
I mean, who else could she be?
Sure.
Unless it's another villain role, right?
That we don't know about,
It could be a young Poison Ivy or something crazy, right? It could be, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
She hasn't been casted yet.
Yeah.
So I really do just want a young Barbara Gordon.
Oh, my goodness.
Because a black Batgirl. Look, I've already talked about these black women in these comic books.
Yeah. No, there's so many directions you can go with it. Like between like doing, you know, Batgirl or doing like Oracle even, like exploring that territory if they wanted to. Like there's just so many different ways that you can sort of explore that and like really expand upon it. So looking forward, you know, to the Batman a lot. The cast is just like going crazy. The only other thing I want to ask about, like at this point, we got a feel for the cast and the roles that they are playing. Like what are the storylines that we, you know, perhaps foresee this movie being about? Like I've heard rumors of, you know, maybe it's going to be an adaptation of Hush, or maybe it's going to be The Long Halloween.
Yeah.
Like, what do we think that might look like for the movie?
It has to be The Long Halloween.
Yeah.
Or, like you said, an adaptation. It's okay to, like, have Long Halloween ideas, right? And venture off.
Oh, sure. And do something else.
Whatever you want to do.
Yeah.
Draw from that for that inspiration.
Yeah.
But The Long Halloween is, the way the characters are set up, that's the only thing I can think of, right? It's like the Sinister Six of Batman. Like,
you are
really setting up all these villains in this one movie. You only have so much time. There's no way the movie's going to be 4 hours, right? So it has to be something like The Long Halloween in my mind, unless at some point they say it's a part one and a part two.
Mm,
that's the only way.
Right.
So yeah,
that's also, you know, it's a story that we haven't seen adapted so far to like any sort of like theatrical on screen.
Top five Batman comic lines.
Yeah,
of all time.
Yeah, for sure. So it'll be really popular if that is what it turns out to
only
be.
Only thing that's missing in my mind, you could have all these people. I would say, like I said, add another woman villain, right? Like a Poison Ivy or something else. And then I would say you add a secret Joker in here.
We have not. Yeah, maybe it's like a new casting.
It could be a new casting. True. Man, you got yourself something else. Or even at the end of the movie, hint at something like a new Joker coming, right?
Sure.
Or people might be tired of that, but it is what it is. The Joker is...
I mean, it's Joker.
He's forever. Yeah, he's Joker forever. It's Joker. Yeah, there's nothing you can do about it.
We're always going to have Joker, so.
Always going to have Joker.
It'll be great, man. I'm super excited for this movie. It's good to finally start to see it come together. We're getting casting news, and we're getting a lot of rumors and stuff. So it'll be here before we know it. It's coming out June 2021. Again, directed by Matt Reeves. Has a great cast already. We'll, you know, sort of stay tuned to see who else might get added over the next few weeks and months and see what this movie ends up shaping up to be. With that said, man, let's move on. We're going to talk about some streaming news. The streaming wars are underway. Shots have been fired already.
Fired.
Things are happening.
Yeah.
When this show is released, Disney Plus will officially be available. It'll be available for the masses. It's been long anticipated for, I think, a couple years at this point since we first heard about it.
Mm-hmm.
We know what's coming at launch. We know what the titles are. And so things are like looking really, really positive for Disney Plus. But then we're also going to talk about the other platform, HBO Max. Some things have been announced for that. But let's start with Disney Plus, man. So like we know what's coming at launch. Let's talk about some of these original series that we're getting. We spoke about The Mandalorian. I mean,
I'm watching that tonight.
Yeah, like ASAP.
I'm staying up. I might buy me an energy drink. I'm staying up tonight to watch Mandalorian.
And apparently there's a big surprise in episode one even.
Word?
Right?
Oh, like, I didn't hear none of that.
Yeah, like they're kind of coming out firing off the top.
Look,
like
please.
With a big surprise, like a big spoiler. So they didn't send out any previews for the show. So that'll be interesting to see what that looks like. But outside of The Mandalorian, which we will, you know, obviously keep up to date with, they're doing a sort of a High School Musical revival.
Yeah.
It's called, let me get this title right now. Let me make sure I got this. High School Musical, the musical, the series.
Right.
Right? That's what it is. Which, a mouthful. Say that three times fast. I dare you. But that, you know, I High School Musical was cool for me.
Really?
But it was also a little bit past, like, my Disney Channel like prime phase.
Really?
Like when I was like really into Disney Channel, it came like right at the end of it. So like I watched it, of course, but I don't think I was as attached to it as like other people might have been. Hey, so
that's my time.
Yeah.
High School Musical is my time.
Definitely,
man.
Legendary though, right?
It's definitely legendary. Again, it came at a good time where there was, again, it wasn't the craziest thing ever, right? But you get like a Corbin Bleu emerges where it's just like this. He may be light skinned, but it's still black representation. You know what I'm saying? And Disney over the years hasn't been like the worst of representation.
True.
But I think at that point in time, there wasn't much going on for black actors. Like you had That's a Raven, and then that in between is super weird though, right?
Yeah.
It was like, oh, here goes Corbin Bleu. Mm-hmm. And I forgot the black girl in the series, my bad. But she was dope too.
Yeah.
And High School Musical was just cool. The music, it was really good. It was really well written, really well composed, and
for sure,
it was dope, man.
Yeah, so I think it'd be cool to, you know, sort of bring it back for a new generation. And from what I remember, you know, them sort of speaking about with the show, it's kind of like not a parody of like the original movies, but they're like portraying the characters from that original movie, so it's kind of meta in a sense.
Yeah.
So like, I'm interested to see like what the take is. So I think I'll check out the first episode to see how I feel about it and see if I keep going with
it. So the trailer was actually looked really decent to me.
Yeah.
Where a lot of people think it's going to be similar to the TV show High School Musical or the movie High School Musical.
Oh,
but
it
doesn't look like that at all to me. It looks more like a teenage reality television show. It looks more like Making the Band.
Interesting.
But it's High School Musical.
That's versus, a fresh take.
A fresh take. And I think Disney understood that, right? Disney didn't want to give us anything too new.
Yeah.
I think High School Musical might be decent, actually. A lot of people are doubting it, but I was looking like, I think people need to go ahead and give this a try.
Yeah.
So we'll see what happens.
So they're doing a live action Lady and the Tramp, which I guess it's continuing with the live action trend of like movies that they've been doing over the past few years.
Right.
I don't know how I feel about it though.
Yeah, I
watched the trailer and the CG dogs like with the live action, like I don't know, it just looked kind of weird. It didn't feel right.
I don't know what they're trying to do. I hope it just doesn't end up like The Lion King, right? Where they're like lifeless.
The faces are just,
don't match
it up. Just doesn't work.
I'd rather have like a, what are those movies? Beverly Hills Chihuahua.
Oh, like yeah.
A Hotel for Dogs or whatever it is where like.
Like a computer generated like version or, yeah, or know, like that.
The dog is moving and the voice is coming out.
Oh,
but,
yeah, yeah.
But their mouth isn't moving.
Right. I see what you're saying. You know what I mean? So it's like their consciousness is almost talking.
Their consciousness is talking, but that's okay to me.
Yeah.
I can do that.
Yeah, it's just kind of strange when you see like a dog's lips like moving and like saying human words. It never really, I don't know if it ever really works, so we'll see how that goes. They're also doing, this is going to be an interesting show, The World According to Jeff Goldblum. I don't know what that's going to be about,
man,
but I want to watch it because him. That's really just why I want to watch it.
Hilarious.
Yeah, he's funny as hell.
He's been tearing up lately, though, but...
Yeah, I mean, I guess it's going to be just him examining just like, I don't know, I guess things relevant to society and the world, and he's probably just going to give his opinion. So.
I hope it's like Bill Nye.
Oh, yeah.
The science guy.
That would be dope.
But he has no idea what's going on with science.
Oh, yeah. He's not a scientist by any stretch of the imagination.
That's what I want it to be like, though. Like, the things that he explores.
He's good enough to carry his own show. And they're also releasing a movie called Noel. It's a Christmas movie.
Mm-hmm.
It's, I believe, Anna Kendrick and Bill Hader are in the movie. I have not. I don't know if they even released a preview for it. I haven't seen anything personally. I just saw the poster.
It was a trailer.
Okay.
I think it was a trailer.
Yeah. I haven't watched like the trailer, but I mean, it's Christmas season, so why not?
Hey, get in the spirit. It also comes out tomorrow.
Yeah.
So we'll check it out, see if it's good or not. Yeah. I like Anna Kendrick a lot.
True.
And she's dope. Bill Hader literally just got done winning.
Exactly.
For Barry.
Yeah.
So.
He's doing incredible things right now. And then, of course, like they also have the endless back catalog of stuff. Like we talked about this a few weeks ago.
Yeah.
Just like the flex that they did with releasing everything that's going to come at launch. I looked at, I think some article broke down like literally how many things it is. It's like over 600 titles of like things that they're bringing to the service.
Over 10,000 hours,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, yeah, like between TV shows and movies and everything. And just today, they announced that 16 out of the 23 MCU movies are going to be available day one at launch. That includes all three Iron Mans, all three Captain Americas, the Avengers, Guardians of the Galaxy 1 and 2, Thor 1 and 2, Doctor Strange, Ant-Man, Captain Marvel, and the big one, Avengers Endgame, all going to be available at launch. So people can definitely get their MCU on if they want to and watch all those movies.
Any idea where the other movies are?
Netflix.
Yeah, oh, they just... Netflix is still holding on to them.
They still got the licenses.
Yeah, makes sense.
Yeah.
Like Black Panther's still on there.
Black Panther, Thor Ragnarok is still on there. Infinity War.
Those are just three really big movies right there that you just named.
Three of my favorites. Disney Plus ain't got them yet. So
really big movies.
Yeah, Netflix is holding on to those. I would assume that they probably have them until the end of the year.
That would make sense.
Yeah, the license probably runs out at the end of this year. Yeah. So I would expect Disney Plus is probably going to have those titles by January.
In my mind, again, for me, it's like kind of no rush, right? Because even the Disney Plus creators, they say they want Disney Plus to be a complement a supplement to Netflix rather than a competitor.
Totally.
They're like, no, you should have both. Like,
yeah.
Disney Plus kind of told us that. They were like, no, you should have both.
100%.
And in my mind, it's like, oh, okay.
Yeah.
You just got to go to Netflix real quick if you want to watch that, you know.
But eventually they'll get it back, right?
Yeah, eventually they'll get it back.
Yeah, so they got a lot of other stuff obviously coming. All the Star Wars stuff that we mentioned a while ago, a lot of the animated stuff, Disney Channel original movies. I mean, they're just coming like really heavy initially with like the launch titles. But of course, like we know that they have like a full catalog of stuff from 20th Century Fox that they have yet to even like tap into.
It's
really
blowing my mind.
Which,
again, like only The Simpsons. I can't even think of anything else.
Like we don't even. It's kind of hard to comprehend because we don't know necessarily everything that includes.
Yeah.
I know like when they start to roll it out, there's going to be a lot of surprises.
It's going to be absolutely ridiculous.
Yeah, like we know the big stuff. Like I know like, oh yeah, Planet of the Apes is a part of that.
Yeah.
Die Hard is a part of that. Aliens is a part of that. Mm-hmm. But like I know there's like hundreds of titles that you just don't think about, right?
You just don't think about.
Yeah, so it'll be crazy whenever they tap into that stuff. Mm-hmm. Disney Plus is launching. It's $5.99 like monthly, right? Or $6.99. One of those. I don't know. It's pretty cheap, actually, comparatively.
People, I have seen articles that have both, and it's so
weird. Oh, both like prices listed?
I think they're just confused.
I think it's $6.99 because I just signed up like last week, and I'm pretty sure that's what it said, which is crazy.
I told you I got 3 years, so.
Yeah, you locked and loaded and ready. Like, you ain't going nowhere.
I ain't going nowhere, man.
The apocalypse can't stop that subscription.
Yeah, I'm like, well.
That's going to be dope. Well, outside of Disney Plus, there's another streaming service that is on the horizon that just also decided to roll out their upcoming library of what they will launch with.
Yeah.
And this service is going to be called HBO Max. Mm-hmm. Now, HBO Max is coming from Warner Media, formerly Time Warner. HBO Max will include properties and titles from notable studios such as Warner Brothers, mm-hmm. HBO, Cinemax, New Line Cinema, DC, CNN, TNT, TBS, True TV, Turner Classic Movies, Cartoon Network, Adult Swim, Crunchyroll, Rooster Teeth, Looney Tunes, and much, much more.
Wow.
That's a lot of shit, man. I don't even know where to begin. Like,
wow.
I didn't realize, like, before they did their launch sort of announcement and conference, mm-hmm. how much stuff they really had under their belt and how much that they could pull from.
As soon as they start naming, like, main TV networks, right?
Yeah.
Like, TNT. I was like, oh, is this what y'all do? Like, yeah. And TBS. And it makes sense, though. Yeah. Like, but I just never put two and two together.
I mean, even CNN, like, we're talking about, like, the largest news organization in the world, basically. And, like, they have access to any and everything with that network. So it's like, we just got to dive into it. So I mean, they did this launch this launch announcement a couple mm-hmm. of weeks ago, I think, and they announced that it will be coming May 2020. They're launching with 10,000 plus hours of content,
so
it's going to be on par with, I think, Disney Plus and other streaming services. They also revealed that the new shows that they're going to develop, all the original content shows, will be released weekly.
As they should be.
As they should be.
It's
HBO. Yeah, right.
HBO's always done that.
They're not abandoning, you know, what they've come to the
party
with.
HBO is still going to be a cable network.
Yeah,
right? Like,
exactly.
You can still go get Time Warner Cable.
Yep.
Which is funny.
And have, right, yeah. Right, yeah. And have that separately.
And still have,
right,
an HBO channel.
Yeah. I've actually had a lot of questions. So let's try to clarify this. Like, I've had mm-hmm. a lot of people ask, like, what's the difference between HBO Max, HBO Go, HBO Now? People don't really understand, like, what's the mm-hmm. difference? What else are they getting with this new streaming service? Like, let's just try to, you know, talk through this. Like, what are people going to get with HBO Max versus what they, you know, already are getting right now, or what they might not already be able to have access to.
So we know HBO Go is if you have a cable service,
yep,
and you already have an HBO package,
yeah,
that you can log in with your TV credentials, right?
And so you really don't got to do nothing. You just got to log in and you have access to all HBO stuff, right?
So HBO Max, when they're announcing all these titles, at the bottom of the page, they're like, click on this page because we have a surprise for HBO Now users.
Oh,
right?
Yeah.
So HBO Now is already a service. It's $14.99 a month. But again, HBO Max is just the new HBO Now to me.
Basically,
it is
turned
an
up
extension,
to like the 10th degree.
Yeah, to the 10th degree. So HBO Max is HBO Now, but you don't have to pay anything extra.
Mm-hmm.
It's still $14.99 a month.
Yep.
You get the same everything as long as you are still billed through HBO.
Oh, okay.
So there's a lot of people out there who are billed through, I don't know, Google Play, or some people have like extension on Amazon
or Hulu.
You should probably just switch your subscription service over to HBO Now, though you don't have to worry about it when HBO Max comes out.
That's actually a good thing to sort of point out.
As long as you're billed through HBO Now, it'll be the exact same price.
Yeah.
Well, I'm pretty sure it'll be the same price anyway.
Sure.
But I think they just wanted to add that contingency just to get you to make sure you just bill through HBO.
Yeah.
I don't know.
It probably is for their numbers to count their subscribers and stuff
crazy,
like that.
Yeah.
So good to break that down. So if you didn't understand, those are the differences between their three different sort of packages. So they also announce all of the stuff that will be available. So mm-hmm. there's a lot of obviously backlog content, licensed content that they're going to have access to. They won South Park, man. They have the streaming rights to South Park.
That is crazy.
Every episode ever. All 20, I think they're in their 23rd season right now. Yep. 300 plus episodes.
And it will air on there after it comes on TV.
Yeah, the day after.
Day after.
So it'll air on Comedy Central at mm-hmm. its regular time slot, and then 24 hours later, it'll be available on HBO Max, the brand new episode. So that's huge. I don't think people realize, like, South Park is still, like, this huge franchise.
People still love it.
That's still going for, like, 23 years at this mm-hmm. point. And so they picked it up, and apparently the price tag for South Park.
Jesus.
$500 million. I felt like Dr. Evil saying that. $500 million to pick up the licensing for South Park.
That doesn't even sound right.
That's crazy.
Are we
Are we sure?
Yeah, I was like, are we sure? Is it really $500 million?
I'm sure that I've never even comprehended what that amount of money looks like. That's what I'm sure about. But they do have it. South Park has been acquired by HBO Max. That alone honestly got me excited because I'm a huge South Park fan.
Yeah, I love South Park,
right?
Too. Yeah.
But I don't even know if that's the biggest thing that they got, bro.
That's not for black people, it ain't.
It's definitely not.
Black people going crazy
they
when they hear what else is coming
up. They got
a
lot of big stuff. So, yeah, we are two black nerds. So, I mean, to talk to our black listeners out there, man, they have the licensing rights for all the episodes of The Fresh Prince of Bel-Air coming to HBO Max. Every season, every episode. That's Which pretty impressive.
People have been missing that for a long
yeah.
time. All I see on Twitter all the time is, I wish Fresh Prince of Bel-Air was on Netflix.
Yeah.
I wish Fresh Prince of Bel-Air was on Netflix.
I'm trying to watch. Yeah,
I'm
yeah,
trying
yeah.
to watch Fresh Prince of Bel-Air yeah. on Netflix. Well, they got it.
They got it now. They got it. All six seasons, I believe, of Fresh Prince of Bel-Air will yeah. be available at launch for HBO Max. I love me some Fresh Prince, man. That was a yeah. show that I loved watching growing Easy. Up. And I could rewatch it
over the
and
same
over
episodes.
And over.
I know
yeah.
words.
All the time.
I can probably know. I can probably verbatim spit 10 episodes.
Yeah, nah, for sure.
By itself.
Yeah, for sure. It's gonna be really, really cool to sort of go back and revisit Fresh Prince. But again, man, I don't know if that's the biggest thing that they picked up, man.
Nah, you don't think
I don't
so?
Know. I can't speak for myself. But I know that there is a huge fan base out here that mm-hmm. loves them some Friends.
There's
they
a lot
love
of
love them some Friends, man. That's another big pickup. That also, I'm sure, cost them a lot of money to get Friends. But they, how do you? I don't even know the song. I gotta watch Friends, man. I gotta get into it.
It's good. Yeah. So a lot of people, actually, this has also been a hot topic.
Yeah,
Friends
yeah.
has been a hot topic recently. For whatever reason. I think ever since people found out it was going off of Netflix.
Yeah, well, Netflix paid for 1 year yeah. $100 million. And I mm-hmm. think people were like, well, wait, hold damn, like $100 million for a year for Friends?
It's that popular.
It is that popular, right? And yeah. like the cultural impact that it's had, and like I know the merchandising has like gone through the roof, like mm-hmm. just like the memorabilia
yeah,
you see
Kyrie,
about Friends.
Kyrie Irving has a freaking shoe
yeah.
that has Friends on the side of
yeah,
it.
Yeah, it's an iconic, you know, sort of show and
it
thing
is.
Like that. So they picked that up. That's gonna be a big thing. And I still have yet to watch this other show that they picked up, but I do want to watch it at some point. The Big Bang Theory. That's another big
oh,
show that they picked up.
Oh, that's one of my
up.
Favorites.
Oh, yeah.
As
so I got to watch that.
As a nerd,
yeah, yeah.
I just, every episode, there's at least two laughs coming out.
Oh, man. Well, yeah. they really got some impressive stuff already lined up, but I don't even know if that's like the most exciting news, man.
Yeah,
the new stuff that they decided to hint at and sort of like let us know is like on the way. There's so much potential here, man. So where should we start? I think we got to start with okay, so we talked about the brands that are going to be available, right?
Mm-hmm.
We talked about brands like, you know, Cinemax and New Line and CNN and TNT that are going to be available on the service, but
right.
we can't forget about DC,
mm-hmm.
right? So like with Disney, you got Marvel,
right.
with HBO Max, you're going to have DC content. They announced a live-action Green Lantern show that's going to be developed by Greg Berlanti, who's responsible for all of the superhero shows on the CW, all the DC superhero shows, Flash, Arrow, Legends of Tomorrow. He's developing a live-action Green Lantern TV show. Did anybody see that coming? Because I sure did not.
Nobody did.
That's
because
crazy.
We've been waiting for it for so long.
Yeah.
If you're any sort of DC fan at all,
yeah.
a DC TV show fan, right? Everyone's like, where the hell is this Green Lantern?
Like, we've been waiting on them because they announced a movie like five years ago.
We've just been like, ever since Ryan Reynolds happened, we've been ignoring them.
Yeah, yeah. Like, they have not done anything.
Yeah.
He was hinted at ever so slightly in Justice League,
yeah. mm-hmm.
which was like a nice Easter egg, but we have not had any sort of Green Lantern announcement. There hasn't been any movies, even not like animated movies, you know, like for home video release. There hasn't really
yeah.
been any Green Lantern content besides
yeah, been,
the comics.
They've
right?
been quiet about it.
Yeah, so the fact that we're getting like a live action TV show is going to be kind of crazy. And I'm also wondering, like, how much is that going to cost? Like,
yeah.
Green Lantern is like an epic space adventure, right?
Yeah.
It's gonna cost a nice pretty penny to like make that show feel real, mm-hmm. right? So it's probably gonna be movie level size budget. So
they better give us some Jon Stewart action.
Oh my
Even,
god.
I like Hal Jordan, don't get me wrong. But
no,
they
John
better,
Stewart, bro.
They better give us some Jon Stewart. Jon
Stewart,
action,
bro.
Man.
Like, let's get all of that. Like, let's mm-hmm. get the whole Green Lantern core. Like, let's just go crazy with it. Go completely bonkers with it. Like, That's
Jessica Cruz.
Oh man,
a nice Jessica Cruz.
Yes, like please do that. If you don't know Jessica Cruz, please
the woman.
Do your Googles.
Hispanic.
Yeah, yeah.
Green Lantern.
That would be so. Yeah, so much potential with
There's
that.
There's a
right?
lot of potential there.
So much potential. They gotta. They gotta really take that above and beyond.
That'd
so
be amazing.
I'm looking forward to that. Mm-hmm. The Boondocks is coming back. Oh. New episodes of the Boondocks will be airing, and I think they're also going to have the first three seasons as well available,
yep.
Plus new episodes. The Boondocks is, I mean, practically one of the most culturally relevant and impactful shows of modern times, I would say.
Mm-hmm.
When it aired, it made all the airwaves. It was always a hot topic of conversation, so the fact that it's coming back after so many years of being gone, hey, man, that in and of itself has my money. Like,
easy.
I know I'm going to be
it's
watching.
The Boondocks.
Yeah, it's the Boondocks.
Again, like, we talked about last week's episode with John Witherspoon. The only thing I don't know about the show is how much they got done.
Right with him, yeah.
For John Witherspoon.
And yeah.
I just pray they have enough
to make
this season, you know, I don't want to say incorrectly, but you know what I mean? I just want it to go out right.
Yeah, yeah, and send them off on a high note.
Mm-hmm.
A couple other things they also announced, like Sesame Street is coming back. They have like 50 seasons of Sesame Street.
So they got this TV show coming out with Elmo.
Oh, yeah.
Called
the
Not Too Late Show.
Yeah, with Elmo.
And I think it's going to go crazy.
It might actually.
I actually think it's going to go crazy.
There's a demographic out there for that. And I mean, you're talking 50 seasons of Sesame Street.
I used to be a really big Elmo fan.
That's
so
wild.
I'm with it.
And then, I mean, they announced so much stuff, man. It's almost hard to keep up. Like, I know that they announced a show with, was it Lupita Nyong'o? Is going to get, like, she's going to produce her own show.
Yeah, so Danai Gurira. She wrote something called Americana, I believe.
Okay, yeah.
And she got Lupita to produce it.
Ah.
So it's definitely possible they both could show up in the show, right?
Mm-hmm.
I really don't know what it's about. But the fact that they're these two crazy powerful black women in this industry are bringing us some content is already crazy to me.
Yeah,
so.
Man. I think that's like the whole thing about these streaming wars. The positive aspect to it, I mean, obviously, I think it's going to probably divide the audience, and there's so many options, it's hard to choose. But I think the positive thing is that we're seeing so many things get made that would never otherwise get made.
Yeah.
Just because of how much is available now with like the platforms. Like, you don't have to put something out in theaters because, like, you know, you're sort of beholden to like box office results. Like, if you don't make money off of a movie, it's not going to get made.
Yeah.
Whereas like a streaming service, like the stakes are a little bit lower. You can take more risks. Like, people can, you know, sort of tap into their producer bag or their writing bag or like just do more projects. I think it's opened up a lot of opportunity just for, you know, for things that we just normally wouldn't see.
Yeah, man. Creatives is definitely helping creatives all over the place, right?
Yeah.
Think about how many black movies you've seen growing up, right?
Yeah.
Versus how many black movies that you have on the fly at your fingertips on like a Netflix, right?
Yeah.
You can literally go to Netflix and type in black movies and like 100 titles pop up.
It's going to be so many. Yeah.
And you couldn't do that before.
Yeah. The access is like opened up tremendously for the landscape. And so I think that's a positive thing. Like, yeah, it's a lot of content. Of course, you're not going to see everything, but I think that's kind of the point. Like, we have so much that it's like, it's a cool opportunity to just be able to curate and pick and choose like what fits your interest, right?
Yeah.
But just to know that it's out there, like if I do ever want to dive into this stuff, like it's available and I can. Like, I think that's a good thing.
They need to take one step further, HBO Max. Like, they need to, you got Fresh Prince.
True.
Go get a Different World. Go get Living Single, right?
Yeah, you kind
of
got to grab all of those while they're available, right?
Get your black viewers.
Yeah, yeah.
I mean, people going to be like, man, they're just trying to get black viewers. So?
Well, yeah, obviously.
The content's there.
That's the demographic.
If Girlfriends was on HBO Max, you tell me you wouldn't go.
Oh, listen,
Girlfriends on HBO Max.
I will.
I'm grabbing HBO Max yesterday.
Yeah, all 10 seasons of Girlfriends.
Especially, I've been talking to people about this recently, how Friends was bitten off of Living Single already.
Oh yeah, that concept.
The
was
whole
taken
concept
from Living
was taken from Living.
Yeah,
Living Single came out like 93 or something like that. Literally a year later.
Yeah.
No.
Here comes Friends and becomes like one of the most popular TV shows ever. Right. So. Yeah, no, I agree. Like, go get this other content, right?
Go get
like,
all this other black content.
It's a lot of stuff that people do want to sort of like revisit. Like, we're also in like a nostalgia sort of era, like where people do want to relive this stuff. Like, A Different World had like a huge revitalization on Netflix. Like,
I remember Amazon Prime too.
Yeah, yeah, I remember like when it debuted. Like, so many people I knew were talking about it and watching it and stuff like that. And I think that's a good thing to revisit that stuff. So if they want to, like you say, take it a step further, man, it's so much still out there that they can like go out and, you know, sort of license out and like really make them a strong competitor in the game.
Right.
So it's a lot to look forward to, but they got a lot coming. They talked about they're going to have 50 original titles available by 2021. So they're aiming for more quality instead of quantity, because Netflix is doing like...
HBO has always done that, though, right?
Yeah, yeah. That's their brand, right?
Mm-hmm.
Whereas Netflix, I think they're more about like the wide array
of
options.
Yeah, they're like,
options.
How much content can we get on
here? Yeah, yeah.
And at some point, some good has to come out, right?
Yeah,
you
right.
Got, you got all this content.
You're going to hit it.
Something's going to be good.
Yeah, something's going to. But exactly. HBO is definitely more focused on, I think, delivering every time out, trying to deliver something memorable that can generate some conversation. So May 2020, man, we'll see what happens. The streaming wars, like we said, underway. Things are getting like real hot and heavy. And then also Apple TV Plus just launched and got like a few new shows out that have been getting some pretty positive feedback. So things are really heating up already. So streaming wars are underway. What are you going to be subscribing to? What are you going to be paying for? Are you going to be paying for anything? Are your wallets going to be able to survive the streaming wars?
Hey, we'll see what happens.
I'm going to have to revisit my budget.
Well, I know for me, technically nothing changes. Because HBO Max is already the HBO I pay for.
That's true. It's already
I already have Prime.
Yeah.
My mom pays for Netflix.
Yeah. Oh, that's how you do it.
My mom pays for Hulu.
Yeah.
And I pay for Disney Plus.
That's what I'm. We're gonna have to start some passwords. Gonna have to get shares. Yeah, accounts. Gonna have to get.
I think we need to start doing math on how many consecutive streams can happen and fulfill that. Right.
Yeah. True.
Like if there's an account that says four consecutive streams, four people maybe should have that account.
Yeah.
That way everyone's saving money across the board. Right. I think there may be too many accounts out there where it's four consecutive accounts and only two people are watching it.
That's true.
Just get two more people on there.
That's a smart way to do it.
It can't hurt anybody.
Yeah. Yeah. It's way more economical. It's a smart way to do it. Yeah. That's how you can, you know, take advantage of almost enjoying everything.
Everything,
right?
'Cause
you can, you know, sort of divide that up across every platform.
Look, I pay for half of the stuff, my mom pay for the other half, and we good. We got it.
That's how you do it, man.
Still cheaper than cable.
Let us know what your method's going to be. Let me know any tips or tricks you got, or if you need a streaming partner to help pay for half of something, let me know, because there's a lot coming, y'all. It's a lot coming.
It really is.
So let's move on, man. We got some movie trailers that have come out. A lot of trailers that just dropped over the past week, you know, for some different projects coming up. We'll just go one by one and sort of, you know, talk about what we think and just, like, give quick rapid fire thoughts. So recently a trailer for a new Apple Plus movie, you know, we're talking about streaming services, Apple Plus is developing a new original movie called The Banker, starring Anthony Mackie and Samuel Jackson.
Nicholas Holt's
also in there.
Nia Long.
So pretty good cast, obviously, and it's based on a true story. Watch the trailer. It seems like a good movie.
It's about two black businessmen who create this somewhat dangerous plan, right, to take on this racially oppressive establishment of the 1950s, right?
Yeah.
So, again, it's the 1950s, a lot of black people can't afford certain houses, right? Like, gentrification is happening all over the place.
Yeah.
And they literally take it upon themselves. What they do is they sneak into a business, and they find this white man who can head the business, right? As two black men, there's no way you're going to be able to head any sort of business.
Yep.
So they find, I believe Nicholas Holt character ends up being the lead, right?
Yeah, yeah.
And they are just working in this building as, like, one's a janitor and one's, I don't know, probably works at the front desk or something.
Yeah,
and they find a way to finesse the system. So that's what it's about, man.
It should be really interesting, man. I'm again, you know, we talked about stories that probably wouldn't typically find a home, but because, like, now this Apple Plus streaming service, TV streaming service exists, like, this is going to be a new movie with a really good cast and an interesting story, it seems like, you know, that we probably wouldn't have heard about otherwise. So I'm excited about it. I think it looks good to me. So I'm going to watch it when it comes out. I think it's December 4th it comes out, or 6th or something like that.
Really, really quick.
Early December, They just dropped a trailer like a few days ago. So they're doing a really quick promotional push for
December 6th.
December 6th, And I think it's going to have a limited theatrical release. So going to check out The Banker for sure. Next up, we're going to talk about Disney and Pixar's brand new movie coming out next year. We've talked about this several times before we even knew exactly what it was going to be.
Right.
Really excited about the prospect of what it looked like it was going to be, and I think the trailer has confirmed this. Soul, which is coming from Disney and Pixar next year, which is starring Jamie Foxx. This movie is going to be important for a couple of reasons. I think one, most notably, being that it's going to have the first black lead in any Pixar movie, which is really interesting, and Pixar is sort of really tapping into a lot of different diverse markets at this point.
Oh, for sure.
We saw what Coco did.
Which
was incredible.
And now here's the finally giving us a black
one. So Soul, the trailer dropped. Don't really have too much about the story so far, I would say.
We have actually no idea what not at all.
It was more so like aesthetic, like it said New York City, which looks gorgeous.
I love the cast. Felicia Rashad, Questlove, Daveed Diggs, and I love Tina Fey. Tina Fey's in it. And that cast by itself.
Heavy hitters, man.
And they're all musical in some way, right? Daveed Diggs, you got this big Hamilton heavy hitter, right?
Yeah.
And then you got Questlove, of course.
Of course,
The Roots. You know what I'm saying? Like, what do you mean? Yeah. Felicia Rashad can sing. A lot of people don't know Felicia Rashad can sing. I actually don't know if Tina Fey has any musical things in her. I've
She wrote Mean Girls for Broadway.
She wrote Mean Girls for Broadway.
Yeah, so I'm sure that there's something
there. I'm sure there's something in Tina Fey, man. I do know there was a lot of backlash with the trailer of this film. Did you know that?
Oh, no, I didn't hear about the backlash.
The backlash with this movie, specifically around the black community, was that why can't a black person go an entire movie without turning into something?
Okay. Because in the trailer, he turns into like...
Yeah, he goes and he falls something. In a... what is it? He falls in a...
I don't even know what it is. It was like a... It was like
a sewer.
Yeah, like a... Yeah, he fell like a sewer.
Yeah, he fell like a sewer.
Yeah.
And it, he turns into a soul.
Yeah.
That's kind of how the trailer goes. He turns into a soul.
Like a representation
and
of his soul.
A lot of people were arguing how that happens, or Princess and the Frog, Tiana gets turned into a frog.
Sure.
Or there was like some other movie with a black dude, spy, and he turns into a bird.
I see.
Or something like that.
Yeah.
Some people were just a little worried. Like, why can't black people just be black the whole movie?
Right, right.
Which I get. Right,
true,
but
we also got to see the movie.
We also got to see the movie.
Like, we don't know how much that's going to play a part of the movie. Like, we don't know how long that's going to happen. If it's going to be like more of a balancing thing, I think like we do got to see the movie before we can like truly make that judgment. I do get it though. I do understand like why that might be a thing though, because like there is a trend of that. Like, can we just like get them to exist as like their human selves for like this entire movie or no?
Yeah.
But you know, we'll see. We'll see what happens when the movie comes out.
And it could be unconscious bias, right? Like,
yeah.
Pixar, just maybe there's not enough black frontrunners in the show that, like, had that thought in the creative room, right?
Yeah, yeah.
Or, yeah, we'll just see. But Pixar is also kind of crazy that way.
Yeah, yeah, like, for sure.
They be making movies about toys and ants.
And it works all the time. It always works.
Inside Out.
The inside
it's
of your
mind.
It's
a movie about emotions.
Yeah, like, literally your emotions inside your head.
There are no people in that movie. Or even Coco. They dead.
Yeah, no, it was, like, literally, like... the physical manifestation of like dead people.
We'll see what
happens. They're always creative with it. I trust them, so I'm looking forward to it.
I have no doubt that this movie will speak in terms of blackness, though, right? In terms of the music, the quality of the music. Again, Jamie Foxx is heading the movie.
Yeah.
So I already know we're about to get some jams.
The talent is there.
Out of this movie, man, regardless.
Totally. Soul comes out next year. Looking forward to that. The next animated movie, sort of keeping along with that, Scoob. They're doing a Scooby-Doo computer animated movie. I did not know this movie was getting made. I had no idea.
Know anybody who knew.
I had no clue. But I will say, I really, really like this trailer.
Yeah.
I thought it was like really good. They're looking at the origin of how... the team came together.
Mm-hmm.
All
this
the people.
Is like a pup named Scooby-Doo age, right?
Like Shaggy,
everyone young as hell.
Scooby, how they met, Daphne, all of them, Fred, like how they basically came together. So we're looking at them, you know, when they're younger, but then also I think when they come together as a team. So I thought it was like a really, you know, it was sort of like a lighthearted, adorable trailer that, you know, sort of spoke to my childhood. I watched Scooby-Doo all the time growing up.
Right.
It was always like a frequently watched show. So I'm interested. I think it looks promising, and I think the cast is like pretty good alongside with it. But you know, I was kind of surprised because, like I said, I didn't know they were making this movie.
Yeah, I had no clue.
Yeah, and you know, we haven't really had like that much new Scooby-Doo content. I know some stuff has come out recently, but I'm also like not the target demographic, so I could have missed like a ton of shit. I don't know.
Yeah,
but, yeah.
And then I'm a huge Scooby-Doo fan.
Yeah.
But I just haven't kept up with the new stuff, right? Like I still love Scooby-Doo.
New generation, but it looks promising though. I think it's.
It looks
good
to me.
Yeah.
It looks good. So.
Yeah, we'll see what that looks like. I think it's coming out next summer, 2020.
Which is actually pretty quick.
Yeah.
I'll take it.
It'll be here. And the last trailer that we're gonna talk about in this episode, The Invisible Man, coming from Universal. Starring Elizabeth Moss. Here's the interesting thing about this though, because so it's The Invisible Man, right?
Mm-hmm.
It's by Blumhouse.
Yeah,
we know makes you know really really popular horror movies.
Yeah,
it's definitely a horror movie, I would say, judging by the trailer.
Yeah.
Now a couple of years ago, Universal they were doing this whole Dark Universe thing.
Mm-hmm.
Remember that? Like they were gonna launch like The Mummy with Tom Cruise, and they had Dr. Jekyll, Mr. Hyde with Russell Crowe. Sophia Boutella was the mummy itself.
Yeah.
And then Johnny Depp was cast as the Invisible Man. Mm-hmm. Like that was gonna be a movie, a part of this Dark Universe.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm wondering, like, is this Like, I know it's separate because they sort of, like, canceled that whole idea of, like, the Dark Universe because the Mummy did not do well.
The Mummy was terrible.
But I'm wondering, like, where this movie came about. Like, was Blumhouse already trying to make this movie, or did, like, Universal pivot and just say, like, oh, well, we got, like, the skeleton of an idea of what we want to do. Let's give it to Blumhouse, who we know makes great horror movies.
Yeah.
We can make it for cheap and make some money off of it.
Probably a little bit of both, man. I really do see them saying, like, man, we got the skeleton of this movie, The Invisible Man. But we actually think this one might be good, you know.
Yeah,
I think
true.
They were like, but let's put it together the right way. Like,
right,
they see
right.
what we messed up in all these other movies.
Yeah.
Or they said, let's actually put it together the right way. So the cast by itself, they did it.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
They got, like you said, Elizabeth Moss, I think, who is still the highest paid actress right now.
Probably.
In television?
For sure.
Highest paid actress in television. Yeah. Specifically surrounding The Handmaid's Tale.
Mm-hmm.
And then you have the young... talented Storm Reed.
Yep.
Who
Storm
is
Reed's
just
coming back
she's
in that.
Doing whatever she needs to do at all times.
Yeah, for sure. So mm-hmm. that's going to be like really interesting stuff to see with The Invisible Man. And so one of the things that I think I'm looking forward to the most about the movie, even though like in the trailer itself, I felt like they showed a lot of stuff because like I was looking at it and I'm like, they're showing a lot in this trailer. Like
yeah.
I'm almost like kind of worried because there were certain parts where I was like, I hope you don't show the whole movie before we go to see it. But there were also, like, some really cool parts in there that I think will, like, grab audiences, like, to go see it,
yeah.
you know, and sort of, like, get them out. I think it's coming out in February,
February 28th.
Oh, that's good. That's, like, a good, like, around Valentine's Day sort of
it's
thing.
Yeah. February's actually turned into, like, this weird horror month.
It's a big
There's
niche
a couple other, yeah, horror films coming in February. And
guess,
I'm like, what is going on here?
I guess we just abandoned October.
We abandoned October and we said, hello, Valentine's
Day.
Yeah,
because, like, October didn't really have anything this year.
Yup, man.
I'm actually kind of confused. This is a tangent. I'm kind of confused why Dr. Sleep didn't come out in October instead of November.
Man.
Because we only had
Dr.
Countdown.
Dr. Sleep,
right?
Annabelle Comes Home.
Yeah, it just, yeah. We've shifted to, like, Valentine's Day in the summer. Yeah.
Oh, well, I guess it did.
Yeah.
Well, but it was still early. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like,
yeah, I don't know. I don't know what that is. But, you know, February, we'll see what happens. I guess it's, like, you know, really prime season for, you know, dates and stuff like that. Go see horror movies. So that makes sense. So, yeah, a lot of new trailers, man. Definitely getting into 2020 movie season to start to see what comes out next year as this year wraps up. So
yeah.
We'll definitely keep an eye out for any more trailers and sort of talk about those things. But. Yeah, definitely check out and keep your eyes out for The Banker, Soul, Scoob, and The Invisible Man. With that said, we will move on to the next thing. So, the Academy, man.
They tearing up again.
Controversy again.
Tearing up again.
It's that time of year, right? I guess it wouldn't be, you know, fall going into winter if we didn't have some controversy from the Academy,
just so
right?
Dumb.
So what's the latest with them, man? What have they done now?
All right, y'all. So there's this Nigerian film called Lionheart.
Okay.
Lionheart is an amazing movie. It's on Netflix right now if you want to go watch it. Maybe we can make it a movie night, maybe.
Mm-hmm.
But Lionheart is this really, really amazing Nigerian film that has been submitted as Best Foreign Film
yep.
of 2019
yep.
For the Academy Awards. The Academy looks at this movie and they go, no, this movie is not eligible to be part of the running for the Best Foreign Film 2019. And Nigeria goes, or not Nigeria, or Lionheart, this movie goes, why? Why can't we, you know, run for this award?
Yeah, why aren't we being considered?
And the Academy goes, because the movie is in English.
But wait. Now, correct me if I'm wrong. Isn't the language spoken in Nigeria... is it not English?
It is indeed English.
So the movie has been disqualified from being considered for Best Foreign Language Film
yeah.
because it's in English, though that is the native language of that country,
right?
Which is technically outside of the Academy. It's a foreign country.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And so now it's not going to be able to be
the dumbest thing I have ever seen, right? This establishment that... clearly, I just don't understand.
That doesn't make any sense.
I really don't get it in terms of... So, one, Nigeria, of course, have been colonized, right, by people who speak English,
true, yeah.
which is why they speak English. In fact, although they were colonized, a lot of Nigerians, which I've seen, you know what I mean? Like, you can quote me on this. Which
yeah.
I've talked to a couple of other Nigerian people, and they say that one of the pros of having English as a language, because Nigeria has so many different languages that English is the one that they agree on a lot of times.
Like, oh, yeah.
Everyone speaks Nigerian, but everyone may not speak this language over here, right? And so this is... They use it all the time.
Yeah.
And they finally get this chance, and Nigeria finally comes through with this crazy good film. Like, a lot of people say, this is the makings of a good film. This film could do great things. And the Academy says no. What's crazy about this is they can enter in everything else except the foreign language film. They can go for best film.
Yeah.
They can go for best everything else in every category but foreign. They won't count it as foreign, but they would count it as everything else.
See, that's just kind of crazy to me because, you know, you're excluding it from this one category based off of whatever idea you consider to be a foreign language film, right? Which, just like, if we're going to be real about it, the Academy still has a lot of really archaic sort of rules and definitions of, like, what should and should not be considered, right?
Yeah.
Like, they're still working under somewhat an old model. I know changes are being made every year, but, it, you know, typically they're only made because of, like, backlash like this. Like, it's more reactionary when they're trying to make changes to, like, these rules that come about. And so it's just, like, here we go again. Like, it's another thing that's happening. Like, it's another thing that y'all are trying to sort of, like, combat now. And, like, y'all are dealing with this controversy because, like, whatever rules you had set up, you don't want to consider it. But listen, just like, at the end of the day, the movie was made in a different country. It is a foreign film. Like, yeah.
It's
like,
in its official language.
And it's the official language.
I believe in the past, Canadian films have been ignored for the exact same reason.
Yeah.
It's like,
it's still crazy.
Like,
man,
what do you mean we speak English?
Yeah. It's,
I don't know,
crazy
what you want us to do out here.
I don't really, because, like, we're also talking about, like, different movie industries too. Like, these different countries operate
under
different
things. All
the
countries
that
have been colonized by the, you know what I mean, by the English, that Australia. So you tell me no Australian film
it's gonna be ever considered.
They speak
for
English.
That. Yeah.
That's what they do.
Yeah. Well, we'll see. We'll see what they do to sort of, like, get out of this. I don't know if they'll maybe make an amendment or change this. I think that they will, because they typically, I feel like they're somewhat good about making changes after they hear, like, that's kind of a bad idea.
But, like, there should be enough people in the room by now to know this is ridiculous.
Right. Exactly. Like, this, this should have all already sort of been prevented. Like, we shouldn't even have to reach to this point. But I guess we'll see what happens over, like, the next, like, couple of weeks. Like, Oscar season is heating up for sure. Things are going to start dropping with, like, announcements and nominations, like, coming in the next few weeks. So we'll see if things change, but it should, man. It should it should totally be nominated for Best Foreign Language Film, as well as any other category it submits to. You know, as long as it meets the simple criteria, like, why the hell not, right? So I still got to check out the movie. If you haven't checked out Lionheart, definitely do that. Let us know what you think about the movie. Also, let us know, like, should it be considered for Best Foreign Language Film? Should it be considered for any other awards at the Academy? Hit us up at Two Black Nerds. Let us know what you think. With that said, man, we're going to move on to the last topic, which is a bit of a it's difficult to talk about. It's definitely
this is
troubling.
It's not easy at all.
Is the whole situation of Alexis Crawford, which, I mean, I've been sort of keeping up with myself, you know, but it's a lot happening with that situation of Alexis Crawford, who, you know, was murdered, and just, like, the things that have been developing with that. But I guess with, you know, everything that's happened so far, like, I mean, it's almost like we're finding out new news every day and new information, but, like, where do we see this going, and just, like, what are our thoughts on, like, the situation
so
far,
again,
and, like, what's happening? So
Alexis Crawford was sexually assaulted by her roommate's boyfriend, and Alexis Crawford goes to the police, and she submits this report that says, the report never said rape, though, but it did say everything it needed to say, right? It said weird touching or something that she didn't like, right?
Yeah.
Sexual assault, easy.
Yeah.
What happened was 4 or 5 days later, I believe she submitted this report on November 1st. November 5th, her body pops up.
Yep.
And Alexis Crawford is dead instantly, right? Of course, 4 days after you submit a report, who we gonna think it is? We gonna think it's the boyfriend.
Exactly.
We think it's her roommate's boyfriend,
yeah,
which it is, right? Which you find out. But what's even crazier is her roommate was in on it too.
Ooh.
Her roommate.
Yeah. This is.
So this her roommate and her boyfriend, or yeah, her roommate and her roommate's boyfriend actually conspired against this girl to kill her. So she wouldn't, so her boyfriend would get in trouble.
Yeah, exactly. And I guess, you know, subsequently tried to cover it up. And
this
know,
happened at Clark
like
Atlanta
that.
University.
Yeah.
And this is just,
it's just really sad, man.
It, like, makes your stomach turn a little bit, right?
Yeah. It's super I don't know. It's sad at the, you know, the end result of what happened, and the fact that, like, this young woman felt like boundaries had been crossed, you know, and went to go do something about it, and then all of a sudden, like, days later, literally days later, she, you know, she's dead. She's no longer here. And so, I don't know, man, just the whole conversation around it is difficult to have, and it's, you know, sort of like a difficult thing to sort of grasp, but I think it just points back to the idea of just, like, the safety of, like, black women, and just, like, how much that's threatened, you know, frequently, and how it's a shame that it's that way. This is also on a college campus.
It is. I just want to call an audible real quick. There are several black women missing in our country right now.
Yeah.
And it's like, that's should be national news. Mm-hmm. Every day,
I'm almost saying
something. I see, like, four different black women come up literally from the ages of, like, 3 to 35.
Yeah. It's too often where I feel like we're saying that.
And it's crazy right now. Yeah. Like, I don't know what's happening, but I need some national attention. I need people to be serious about this. Yeah. It is not a game.
Yeah, something is really off right now.
But again, going back to Alexis Crawford, I just want to understand what compelled, is it love that compelled this woman to conspire with her boyfriend to kill her? Because her family actually said they were like two peas in a pod. Her and her friend and her roommate. You went from two peas in a pod to killing her?
That's a revelation, because how does that make sense, right?
Like, two peas in a pod to killing her for this man?
Right.
This your boyfriend?
What drives somebody to that
point? I've heard, like, love blinds, but not always love brainwashes. Like, this is, I'm not saying this is isolated, right? Like, this happens before. Like, I've seen it.
And is that truly love, right?
Is that really love?
Are you ever going to do something like that to somebody you claim to care about? You know what I'm saying? And, like, what does that look like, really? Like, did you really care for this person, or what did they truly mean to your life that at a certain point you felt compelled to take a life, right? And to do it with, like, your boyfriend, and to conspire and come up with this plan and do it. I don't you know, it bothers me a lot, you know, again, because, like, again, it happened on a college campus, and so, like, it just makes you, like, worry about, like, damn, you know, where is it safe, you know, where stuff. And I mean, we know the troubling history of, like, college campuses too, because, like, there's, like, a history of, like, sexual assaults that are, you know, end up, either the stories are never told or they're covered up. There's this documentary out there about just, like, athletics and how that's played a part in, like, sexual assaults on college campuses, which is, you know, a very difficult watch. I can't remember the name of it right now, but just all of that stuff, like, just how much is covered up, is really, it bothers me a lot just to know how frequently this still, you know, happens.
For me, the narrative is, it's another one of those things where a woman can't even say that she's been sexually assaulted, which is, we've been talking about this for years now, decades now, right? Where every time a woman says anything, like, why didn't she just come out and say she got sexually assaulted?
Yeah, she gets shamed for not speaking.
Yeah, she gets shamed for not speaking about something that happened to her, right? Some sexual act or sexual assault that happened to her. And look what happened this time.
Here we are,
A girl got murdered.
The worst case scenario.
This is not a game.
Yeah.
It's really not.
It's not. It's not at all. So I just, you know, I just want to say thoughts and condolences to, you know, the family of Alexis Crawford. It's incredibly sad that this happened. I couldn't imagine, you know, somebody close to me being in this type of situation, somebody that I cared about. And I don't know. I wish it didn't happen. I wish stuff didn't end up being a reality, especially, like, from our own, you know, to see, like, a black woman, you know, be murdered in this way, from people that you would assume she was close with also, which is, I don't know. It's just, it's a really tough thing to sort of grapple with. So definitely thoughts and prayers.
I just want people to know that it is on the table right now. They're looking at life.
Yeah.
They're looking at life. Oh, yeah, I believe it's called malice intent or something like that.
Malicious intent or something like that, yeah.
But they are, again, they're looking at life, man. Simple as that. They killed a girl.
Yeah.
They're the ones that confessed, by the way.
Right.
They confessed. They didn't even, they technically didn't even have to do the biggest investigation in the world. Mm-hmm. They were just like, nope, we killed her, and they came forward. And so,
Wow. Well, we'll continue to see what happens with the situation, but the worst has already happened. It's super unfortunate. But again, just condolences out to the family and friends of Alexis Crawford. We just want to send our thoughts their way. So those are the topics that we have for this week, man. Episode 6 of Two Black Nerds is a wrap. Like we said off top, y'all, thank you again for all the support and all the love so far.
Yeah.
We spoke recently about a few ideas that we got coming along the way. We talked about the Two Black Nerds movie club recently that we're going to do.
Please stay tuned.
Stay tuned for that. We're going to pick a movie soon. So.
Yeah, we're picking a time and a movie soon. So stay tuned on Twitter and on Instagram. We're going to do a poll in both places to see what time and movie works for you guys.
Totally.
It may not be a movie you know, but that's kind of the point, right? And it may be a movie you know, but that's also the point. It could be any movie.
It'll be a surprise, whatever we choose. Whatever so definitely looking out for that. And then we also, again, like we said, we're going to end this year off with our top lists of the decade. We have a lot of lists to get to. We're going to break down the top movies of the decade. Yeah. We're going to look at the top hip-hop albums of the decade, the top R&B albums of the decade, and the top comic book superhero movies of the decade. Yeah. So we got a lot of homework to do on our end. I'll just let y'all know that, but we're going to bring that to you before the year is over, these different lists.
I think
just breaking down all the best of the 2010s.
I think pretty soon we're going to do, let's go ahead and do this Christmas list, man. Top 10 Christmas movies.
Oh yeah, Christmas movies.
Let's do top 10 Christmas.
I just bought a bunch of Christmas movies, so yeah, we can definitely do that. Yeah. It's a lot of good stuff to get into for the holidays, because we definitely are well into November now.
That should come out pretty soon.
Yeah,
we can work on that.
Definitely. So we got a lot coming for y'all, man. Two Black Nerds, as always. Make sure, you know, follow us on social media, Twitter and Instagram at Two Black Nerds. Hit us up on any podcast channel, wherever you get your podcasts, Apple, Spotify, YouTube, Radio Public, Breaker, all the things, everything. Leave a comment, leave a rating, show your support, subscribe, like I said. We appreciate it as always, man. That's it for this week. We'll be back next week, as always.
As always, yeah, man. We appreciate y'all. And again, this has been Two Black Nerds, where we're too black,
too nerdy,
and we out. Peace.